Hi all, welcome to our new initiative Smart Catalyst. We have been doing our newspaper analysis from July 2nd, 2018, but we received more comments from the aspirant community that we need to expand our domain of analysis. We were doing only based on the Hindu. Now we have enhanced and enriched our content, including the news items from Indian Express, Mint and PIB. So this initiative would give a new enriched experience to the aspirants to clear their exams. We all know what a catalyst does in a chemical reaction. A catalyst, either in few cases, it initiates a reaction, and in many cases, it increases the speed by through which the reaction takes place. And with our smart catalyst, we are aiming to activate the aspirations of the aspirants in clearing this exam. We have extensively covered the news items from different sources, say Hindu, Indian Express, Mint and PIB. And in order to keeping the duration of video in mind, we have not covered few topics in this discussion. Rather, we have covered few topics under MCQ. We have given few MCQs and the PDF is available for download in the link provided in the description. Please download the PDF for your reference. So our new current affairs initiative, Smart Catalyst, has three levels. The first level is online, what we are doing now. The second is offline classes, in which the topics covered in the level one will be covered in an elaborate and detailed manner. And our new batches are starting on October 21. You can contact our office for further details for our offline classes. Also, a month before the prelims, we will be organizing a crash course in which the complete current affairs which happened all through the year will be covered in a very rapid manner, which will be a revision module for the aspirants. Let's move to the first article. The first article is on changes being mooted to the sexual harassment law. So what is the background of this news? We have witnessed the Me Too campaign in social network. And because of this Me Too campaign, the central government has announced its plan to set up a committee with legal experts in order to bring in changes to the sexual harassment law 2013. So what this article is speaking about? This article is speaking about the recommendations issued by Verma committee. Justice Verma committee was formed after the Nirbhaya incident in Delhi, and they have given some recommendations, and these recommendations were not implemented in this. According to Sexual Harassment Act 2013, any company that employs 10 or more women has to establish an internal complaint committee. And this internal complaint committee, it acts as a civil court while adjudicating the complaints made by the women employees. And Justice Verma committee has mentioned that this ICC can become counterproductive, because a woman being harassed in a particular office, going to complain about a higher official or a colleague in the same office will not yield required results, and it could become a counterproductive measure. And also, committee has recommended introducing a procedure based on Verma committee has recommended introducing an employment tribunal instead of ICC, that is internal complaint committee. And this tribunal will have to choose the procedures based on the nature of complaints rather than being a carte blanche civil court powers. Also, the 2013 act had an option for penalizing the women for false complaint. Justice Verma committee has opposed this particular provision of the act, citing that this provision is an abusive provision intended to nullify the objective of the law. So these were the initial recommendations made by the Verma committee. I have added an image which explains the core crux of the recommendations made by the Verma committee. The committee has also spoken about the employer liability. What are the liabilities for the employers when there is a complaint on sexual harassment? The employer could be liable if he or she facilitated sexual harassment, permitted an environment where sexual misconduct becomes widespread and systemic, where the employer fails to disclose the company's policy on sexual harassment, and the ways in which the workers can complain over the sexual harassment violations against them. These were the employer liability provisions recommended by the Justice Verma committee in its report 2013. With increasing incidence of sexual harassment against women in workplace, the government has to take proactive measures in order to curtail the sexual harassment of women at workplaces. This would ensure labor force participation of women in India, which would have greater impact on India's economic growth. The second article is about feminization of agriculture. This article appeared in the center page of Hindu. So what is the background of this article? Today is October 15. October 15 has been declared as International Day of Rural Women by the United Nations. Also, in India, the day has been declared as National Women Farmers Day, Rashtriya Mahila Kisan Divas. Women play a multidimensional, multifarious role in agriculture. What are the roles they play? They involve in hoeing, they involve in weeding, they involve in fertilizer application, they involve in harvesting. These multidimensional roles has been recognized by the government under this Rashtriya Mahila Kisan Divas. In order to celebrate, in order to encourage women participation in agriculture, the government has been organizing this particular day. So the article has given us some important data pertaining to participation of women in agriculture. Data becomes most important in as far as the mains are concerned. Let's see the data provided by the article. According to a survey conducted by Oxfam India, 60-80% of farmers involved in fruit production are women, and 90% of the farmers involved in dairy production are women, but their participation remains largely unnoticed. Also, the Agriculture Census 2010-11 has estimated 118.7 million cultivators in India. Of them, 30.3% were females. And the census has also estimated 144.3 million agricultural laborers in India. Of them, 42.6% are females. And the recent agriculture census, which was taken in 2015-16, has given us some data. It has estimated that of 146 million operational holdings, the proportion of female operational holding is very meager, and it's only 13.87%. Also, 86% of the women farmers, they don't have land ownership right. They cultivate the land, they involve in multidimensional activities to increase the productivity of the land, but they lack ownership rights, and it has telling impact on their financial stability. We have added a infographic in this slide. So what does it mention? It compares India's female landholding in India with other low income countries. India stands at a middle path of 0.5, and this is very low comparing to other underdeveloped countries of Africa. We need to make proactive measures to increase landholding by women. The article has spoken about a few issues, and one of the most important issues is land ownership. In India, land is associated with power, and in the patriarchal society, power is most important for upliftment of women, and lack of land owning rights has caused powerlessness. This has impacted women's empowerment in India. Keeping women empowerment in one side and considering about the financial inclusion and the formalization of credit taken by the farmers, we stumble upon a starking contrast that because of this lack of land owning rights, women farmers, they are not able to avail institutional credit from the banks. So the author has recommended to provide collateral free microfinance loans through NABARD. The women workforce forms an invisible workforce in agriculture, and this is inevitable for agricultural sector to grow in India. Without women participating, without women contributing more to the agriculture, the government's aim of doubling the farmers' income by 2022 is very hard to achieve. Another important issue plaguing the agricultural sector in India is declining land size. This has also got impact on the women farmers. Majority of Indian farmers, they fall under the marginal farmer category. That is, they own less than 2 hectares of land. Because of this decline in land size, it has created lower net returns for the farmers and lack of adoption of technologies in agriculture. Following the footsteps of self-help groups, collective farming should be made an option to improve women participation in agriculture. Training and imparting skills to the women should be done in a proactive manner to improve their livelihood. The better example is dairy cooperatives like Amul. Also, the author has spoken about increasing the role of farmer production organization to improve the state of agriculture in India, especially women participation in agriculture. Women in India face inequality in different fronts. And as far as agriculture is concerned, the most important inequality they face is on farm machinery. The farm machinery are designed to be used by men folk. Women face discomfort to use these farm machineries. This has impacted the women participation in mechanization of agriculture in India. So the author has suggested that it is important to have gender-friendly tools and machinery for various form operations. This would improve the net profit arriving out of the agricultural operations. FAO, the Food and Agricultural Organization, an affiliated body of United Nations, suggested that making the farm machineries gender-friendly will have a positive impact of 2.5 to 4% on global agri-production. So making farm machineries gender-friendly becomes more important. So what is the way ahead to improve the productivity of women in India's agricultural scenario? The first one would be assigning land rights to the women. Second, allowing technology insemination in a gender-friendly manner. And apart from all these, we need buyers. We need purchasers of the food grains to improve the income of farmers. And the government should take initiatives in order to channelize the wholesale buyers from the women farmers. Consistent, collective and cooperative action is required to improve the participation of women in India's agricultural sector. This would really help in India achieving the target of doubling the farmer income by 2022. The next article is about the possible role of India and China in developing Africa. So why this news has appeared? Every news has a background. The background of this news is that China has recently announced a $60 billion package for African countries, development of African countries, in the inaugural of the Forum on China-Africa Cooperation. So this is the background of this news. And India has also been involved in many developmental projects in Africa. Now China has started to invest in developmental projects of Africa. Historically, Africa has been a place for European countries' imperialism and neo-imperialism. Now they have decolonized and they have started to undertake their own developmental projects through their democratically elected governments. Now the observers feel that involvement of China in development of Africa would ensnare the continent into another round of political serfdom by invoking the debt trap. We all know that China has been accused of pushing countries into debt traps through its CPEC as far as Pakistan is concerned, and many other Central Asian and African countries through its OBOR project. So what has been India's role as far as Africa is concerned? India has been organizing triennial events from 2015. The author has suggested that an imaginative coordinating mechanism between India and China would largely help the development of Africa. How it's going to help? Because China has their manufacturing ability and India has ability in services sector. Apart from that, India has a soft power advantage over China. This would curtail the spread of wings by the Chinese dragon. This would help in curtailing the hegemony of China in Africa. Also, in a recently concluded Johannesburg BRICS summit, a Chinese foreign minister has spoken about China-India plus one or China-India plus X model, that is including a third country in engaging with African continent. This can be seen as a continuation of the informal summit in Wuhan between India and China, where both the countries decided to have a cooperative action on developing South Asian countries, especially in Afghanistan. The author has concluded that India should pick up the threads and weave a potent emerging economical narrative for bonding with Africa, and this would trigger a structural shift of global significance. The next topic is about analytical report of National Health Profile 2018. The topic has been taken from PIB, mainly on prelims perspective. So if we analyze the previous year question papers of preliminary examination, we can observe that the questions have been directly picked from the news items that appeared in PIB. So PIB's news items becomes more important as far as prelims are concerned. So they will minutely change the data, or they will change the nature of the statement in order to confuse the aspirants. So what is this analytical report of the National Health Profile speaking about? This report is published by the Central Bureau of Health Intelligence, which is under the aegis of Director General of Health Services, and it's located in Patna. And this CBHI has been releasing this particular analytical report for the past 12 years from 2005. What does the report cover? The report cover four broad areas. One is the demographic health profile. The second is socioeconomic health profile. The third is health status of citizens of India. And The fourth and the most important is about health finance indicators, because the report suggests that more than 7% of the Indian population are pushed into the poverty line because of the out-of-pocket expenditures. So understanding health finance indicators has become too crucial to improve the status of health in India. So this report has led to the launch of National Health Resource Repository. So what is this repository is all about? This repository is country's first ever national healthcare facility, has authentic information about the healthcare services in the country, and these healthcare centers and health facilities has been geospatially marked. And this registry all contains information about public and private healthcare facilities. So what is the vision of this particular registry? And this registry aims to strengthen the evidence-based decision making. The main vision, the main aim of this registry is to strengthen evidence-based decision making. Data is too crucial. Competent data is too crucial for a comprehensive decision making. So this registry is aimed at decision making. The registry is also aiming at developing a platform for citizen and provider-centric services by creating a robust, standardized and secured IT-enabled repository for India's healthcare resources. This repository also includes the hospitals and healthcare establishment under the aegis of Railways, ESIC, Defence and Petroleum Healthcare. ISRO has been roped in as a technology partner to ensure data security of India's healthcare facilities. This repository will cohesively work with Ayushman Bharat program and Central TB division on an integrated plan, ensuring a larger benefit for hospital empanelment and private sector engagement. The next article is also taken from PIB, keeping prelims in mind. And this article is about Human Capital Index. So Human Capital Index is a report released by World Bank. And we all know that UPSC has a knack of asking questions on reports. So just remember, Human Capital Index, the report is released by World Bank. And this has been released as a part of Human Capital Project. So what is the objective of the project? We are now witnessing a rising income inequality in the world, and the important reason for increasing income inequality is a gap prevailing in human capital of individuals. This report, the objective of the index is to show how low education and health outcomes impact productivity, growth and prosperity, thus pushing the world into the trap of inequality. So this human capital index has three broad components. One is survival rates, second is education, and third is health. And it covers broad parameters. The survival rate is measured based on the probability of children seeing their fifth birthday. Education is measured in the terms of average number of years that children can expect to go to school, and in terms of how much they are actually learning. It's about enrollment and quality of learning a children undertakes in its formative years. Parameter is about health. Health is measured by the proportion of children who are not malnourished and the probability of a 15-year-old child to live through her entire working age and celebrate her 60th birthday. Where does India stand as far as this report is concerned? India stands at 115th rank out of 157 countries. The overall score of India based on the three parameters is 0.44, which is very low and is dismal comparing to the other neighboring poor countries of India like Bangladesh and Nepal. Even while comparing India with its other developing peer economies, the stance of India is very low. It is imperative that India has to focus on improving its human capital in order to bridge the gap of inequality in Indian setup. The next article is about misuse of antibiotics in India. So this topic has relevance in all GS papers of mains examination. UPSC has of late has got the practice of having a flexible syllabus. See, this year we had a question on CPEC appearing in paper 3 under security section. So this topic has relevance in all four GS papers. This topic has been picked from the Hindu. So what? Let's see the background of antibiotics in India. Why has this antibiotics misuse has appeared in news? In a recent investigation, it was found that US-based veterinary drug maker Zotys has been selling its antibiotic drug mainly used as growth enhancers in India's poultry industry. The company is continuing to sell this antibiotic in India, whereas it has stopped selling this antibiotic in USA. This is because in 2017, US banned the use of antibiotics as growth promoters. But India doesn't have any regulatory framework to curtail the use of antibiotics as growth promoters in poultry industry. Because of this prevalent widespread misuse of antibiotics, these antibiotics lose their efficacy against deadly infectious diseases. This has led to the antimicrobial resistance. What is this antibiotic resistance? Antibiotic resistance is a naturally occurring phenomenon that can be slowed but that cannot be stopped. This is an evolutionary process. The bacteria over the time acquires the ability to withstand the drugs that are designed to kill those bacteria. This process makes the previously standard treatments for bacterial infection ineffective. And this has led to the coining of a new term called superbug. A superbug is usually defined as a microorganism that is resistant to commonly used antibiotics, but not all superbugs are created equal. What are the different sources of resistance? The article has spoken about three different sources of resistance. One is the anthropogenic factors, that is humans using. Of late, doctors have been recommending more antibiotics to treat the diseases. This is one factor. The second is veterinary factor, where the antibiotics are used as growth enhancers in poultry and other meat production industries. Also, there are instances of antibiotics being used in agriculture. The third aspect is about environmental antibiotic contamination due to the discharge of antibiotic effluents into the water sources or into the ground by the pharmaceutical companies. These are the three major sources of resistance. And a recent research undertaken by PLO's medicine paper suggests that 416 persons of every 1 lakh persons in India dying because of infectious diseases every year. This data indicates the precarious position of infectious disease in India, and it is time to focus more on controlling the menace of this antibiotic resistance in India. What are the issues pertaining with the regulation of antibiotics in India? First, the antibiotics are listed under Schedule H1 of Drugs and Cosmetic Rules 1945. These drugs are known as scheduled drugs, and these drugs cannot be sold without any prescriptions. Still, these Schedule H1 drugs are freely available in pharmacies for over-the-counter purchase, and the state drug controllers are unable to control the sale of antibiotics without prescription. This is a fallout of administrative machinery. India's 2017, India has released a national action plan on antimicrobial resistance in 2017. It has provided space for prohibiting the use of antibiotics as growth enhancers. But this policy initiative has not been executed. This has led companies to sell their last resort drugs to the farmers without any control. Also, the 2017 document has spoken about the discharge of antibiotic effluents from pharmaceutical companies. For example, recently it was found that Hyderabad's pharmaceutical industry pumping massive amounts of antibiotics into local lakes, leading to the development of antimicrobial resistance. A study undertaken in 2013 estimated that more than 58,000 children, that is newborn children in India, they died due to an infectious disease called sepsis. And with all these anthropogenic, veterinary and environmental contaminating antibiotic discharge happening all around the country, it is high time that the government should take proactive measures to prevent the misuse of antibiotics in India and to act on reducing and act on restricting the growth of antimicrobic resistance in India. The next article is about the Sabarimala verdict given by Supreme Court. The author has mentioned that this verdict given by the Supreme Court has rewritten the constitutional dispensation on freedom of equality, religion and untouchability. Because the judgment, the judges have equated Article 17, the rights conferred under Article 17 with rights conferred under Article 25 and 26. So this article speaks about the growth of religious institution in India, because the Article 25 and 26 speaks about religious denomination and religious endowments. So the religious endowments were first initiated by the Britishers in India. So the legacy starts from the Religious Endowments Act 1863, the Charitable Endowments Act 1890 and the Civil Procedure Code 1908. These were the decisions taken by the government before independence. After post-independence, the government of India had undertaken few measures, and apart from these executive action, there has been actions undertaken by the Supreme Court based on the cases filed between 1950 and 2018. The Supreme Court has given more than 95 verdicts relating to the religious rights in India. And we are going to discuss the few of those important verdicts. We all know that the religious denominations in India have been conferred rights from Article 25 to Article 28 of Indian Constitution. Also, the India's brand of secularism has led to the concept called as nationalization of religion. After independence, many state governments from the states of Bihar, Tamil Nadu, Odisha, Andhra Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and Kerala, they passed few acts, and based on those acts, the sites of religious importance, say temples and Buddhist viharas, saityas, they have been taken under the control of state. So this has led to the term called nationalization of religion. These regulatory laws introduced by the state governments, they created furor among the religious denominations of the country. Numerous cases were filed against these provisions, and first among that was Shirur Math case of 1954. What the Supreme Court has said in that court? What was the Supreme Court's verdict? The Supreme Court considered the ring test of compatibility between these laws and the provisions of management, propagation, belief, practice mentioned in Article 25 and 26 of our Constitution. The strategy followed by Supreme Court in that particular case was twofold. The first one was to protect the essential practices of the faith, and the second one was to balance these practices and faith against the insistent exigencies which tried to control those practices. For example, in few cases, Supreme Court has declined to accredit the status of religious denomination to the followers of Aurobindo and to the followers of Anand Marga. This was based on public order, morality and health provisions of our Indian Constitution. And in these cases, the Supreme Court has given the test of integral and essentiality, whether those practices are integral to that particular religious denomination and how far those practices are essential to that particular religious denomination. These two factors has been made as an testing criteria to protect those religious denominations. In the Venkatramana Devaru temple entry case 1958, the premises of the case was that the temple was built by a particular sect of people for their own use, and they stopped untouchables from entering the temple. Supreme Court saw this as a conflict between Article 17 and religious freedom conferred under Article 25 of Indian Constitution. And the untouchables were allowed to enter the temple, but not to the inner sanctum. The second case is Yagna Purushaji case 1966. The Supreme Court declined to recognize the followers of Swaminarayan sect as an individual separate religious denomination. In Kasi Vishwanath case 1997, Supreme Court, based on the parameters of integral nature, it defined the essentiality of religious practice in defining them as a separate religious denomination. So this gave a ring test of integral nature. In the recent case, Babri reference case 2018, the non-essentiality of a place of worship was discussed by the Supreme Court. And the last and the most important case we are discussing now is about the Sabarimala case, which has allowed the women between the age of 10 and 50 to enter the Sabarimala shrine. While adjudicating this dispute, our honorable judges, they saw a conflict between the Article 17 and religious freedom conferred under Article 25 to 28 in Indian Constitution, not allowing women and restricting people from entering the temple is a part of our customary morality. Supreme Court has opined that the customary morality has no place against the constitutional morality. In a democratic society, constitutional morality has to guide the actions of the people and the government. So the rights conferred under Article 17 was applied, and constitutional morality, which included equality and gender justice, was upheld. And there was also a minority view offered by the bench. In this particular case, Justice Indu Malhotra gave a minority verdict. The minority verdict was based on the context of public morality and not on constitutional morality. The next article is about the need for updating India's plan to tackle climate change. We have been seeing a series of articles appearing in different newspapers relating to the recent report of IPCC. So we all know that under the ambit of UNFCCC, the countries have decided to restrict the temperature rise at least by 2 degrees Celsius, and with a broader aim of restricting the temperature rise by 1.5 degrees Celsius at the pre-industrial level by 2100. What are the possible implications of climate change? One important and crucial implication is rise in sea level. So rise in sea level would be very high when the temperature rises 2 degrees Celsius by 2100. And if we are successful enough in restricting the temperature rise under 1.5 degrees Celsius, the sea level rise would be 10 centimeter lower than what it would have been under 2 degrees Celsius rise. Another important negative implication of climate change is melting of Arctic ice. So the report suggests that if we restrict the rise of temperature by 2 degrees Celsius, the frequency of Arctic ice melting would be in every decade. And if we are good enough to restrict the rise of temperature by 1.5 degrees Celsius, the likelihood of Arctic Ocean free of ice would be an event happening once in a century. Also, the report suggests that the coral reefs, which are known as the rainforest of the ocean, they may survive with 10 to 30% probability in 1.5 degrees Celsius case, while being virtually eliminated if the temperature rises around 2 degrees Celsius. So, what is the most important step to be undertaken to contain climate change? The most important step is to reduce carbon dioxide emission, that is carbon dioxide removal. This CDR of 100 to 1000 gigaton carbon dioxide equivalents over this century has to be undertaken in order to restrict the ill effects of 2 degrees Celsius rise in global temperature. So what should be the possible measures to restrict the rise of temperature under 1.5 degrees Celsius? The first one is to improve the share of renewable energy in global power equation. If at all we can achieve 75% or more of renewable energy by 2050, we have the chance of restricting the temperature increment by under 1.5 degrees Celsius. The second is about afforestation. The forests act as an sink for carbon dioxide. They absorb carbon dioxide. This will reduce the prevalence of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The third aspect is about changing the dietary habits of the people. The recent researches have found that rearing animals for meat has increased the prevalence of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. This in turn has led to the increasing of temperature in the global atmosphere. The fourth aspect is about changing the modes of mobility, like moving out from motorized vehicle to non-motorized mobility like cycles, also from polluting fossil fuel run vehicles to electricity vehicles. The fifth aspect is about carbon sequestration, by which the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere are trapped underground, by which the rise in temperature is restricted. Recently, a Nobel Prize in Economics was offered to American economists for their work on climate change related macroeconomic theory. In their papers, they have recommended about introducing uniform carbon tax for all the countries. The seventh and the most important measure would be improvising on sustainable modes of urbanization and infrastructural developments all over the world. Also, the author speaks about the often raised dilemma between sustainability and development. So now we have witnessed the global superpowers turning away from climate change, like United States of America, and now Brazil has been in the process of electing a leader who is opposing the climate change initiatives. So can we say that now it's India's turn to pollute in order to improve its economic prospects? Electricity is most crucial for India's economic development, and under the INDCs proposed by India in Paris climate meet, we have offered to produce 100 gigawatts of renewable energy. But in contrary, in India's draft energy policy, we have decided to improve the electricity produced by coal-based power plants in double the electricity produced by coal-based power plants by 2030. So these are conflicting views presented by the government. The government should focus on development which is induced by sustainability, which protects environment in turn. As we discussed earlier, the Nobel Prize in Economics was offered to the economists who were working on linking climate change and macroeconomics. And the recent IPCC report suggests the economic value of guarding our climate. India should take it as a valuable reminder in order to create cogent policy with respect to climate change and environmental sustainability. To conclude with, the author has mentioned that India has to undertake the following measures in order to restrict the temperature rise. The first one is about mitigating the greenhouse gas emission. Second one is improving the adaptation for climate change. The last important measure is to build robust and healthy financial mechanisms to fund the resilience projects. The next article has been taken from Mint newspaper. This article is speaking about the how the Payment Boards Act 2018 has created unwarranted actions. So what is this draft payment and settlement system bill 2018 is all about? The bill seeks to improve competition, consumer protection and systemic stability and resilience in payment sector by providing level playing fields to non-bank players like fintech companies. The bill mainly focuses on introducing new players into the financial transaction space, that is a fintech company. With the rise of internet, we have witnessed more number of fintech companies in India, and in order to regulate this, and normally all those financial transaction institutions fall under the purview of RBI. While breaching this regulatory control of RBI, this bill is aiming to introduce an independent regulatory board for fintech companies or non-bank players who are involved in financial transactions. How money is being circulated in an economy? Money is being circulated in economy mainly through the banks. Now, the recent bill has proposed to introduce a new player in that field, non-bank players, the fintech companies. What comes into our mind when you speak about fintech companies? The first one is the credit and debit card company gateways like Visa, Master and other payment gateways. So what is the current scenario in financial transactions? Of late, in the past few years, we have seen the digitization of payments increasing in India. Use of POS system, that is point of sale systems for debit and credit cards, has involved more additional costs for such payments. The transaction which was free, money-based transaction which doesn't incur any cost from the side of buyers, has been replaced to some extent digital means, and this digital means has led to additional cost being incurred by the consumers. The account holders, they sacrifice nearly 3% of their investment for enjoying such services. The non-bank entities can also pose threat to the banking entities through the popularization of UPI, says the author. Also, the merchant discount rate for debit cards is around 0.9%, whereas for credit cards, it's around 2.5%. This has also impacted the digitalization of financial transactions in India. The author suggests that the MDR rate for credit cards should also be brought down to the level of debit cards in order to improve digitalization of financial transactions. RBI has been a front runner in improving the digitalization of financial transactions. Earlier, for transferring a sum of money under RTGS, the fees were around ₹1,000, and for a withdrawal from ATM, the user charge was around ₹35. This was the case in 2007, but with the proactive actions being undertaken by the RBI, these costs have come down, which has expanded the space for digitalization in financial transactions. The introduction of National Payments Corporation of India has also helped in the same cause. NPCI has introduced IMPS Immediate Payment Service, UPI, RuPay, Bharat Bill Payment as a services to the account holders of banks. Apart from this, the NPCI checks monopoly of profits by returning back the surplus made in the process. NPCI is also working on reducing the transaction fees and works as the extended arm of the government and RBI in spurring the growth of digital payments. What are the challenges being faced by the digital transactions in India, and how this bill has proposed to tackle those challenges? The first challenge is about the regulatory purview. Already, the RBI is creating regulatory barriers for the expansion of fintech companies in financial transactions. The best example is about white label ATMs, where the private entities who were not related to any of those banks were allowed to open ATMs. But the provision of having white label ATMs in rural areas and other regulatory provisions has restricted the growth of white label ATMs in India. Also, the fintech players experience thin margins. Apart from this, RBI has been the front runner of providing financial inclusions to the masses of Indian society. But introducing a new regulatory board will breach that regulatory power of RBI and will have an telling impact on India's financial inclusion. A board to regulate new technology is always welcome, but it should have transparency. So the first way to move towards new board is to introducing transparency in the functioning of that board. Second, improving the existing powers of RBI in regulating the fintech transactions. Also, spurring the spread of digital payments should be based on consumer interest, monetary policy concerns, and strategic sovereign interest. These three factors has to be considered while spurring the growth of fintech companies.